Okay, I'm going to talk about the final type of gene transfer, and that's transduction. Okay, there's two different types of transduction. There's generalized transduction and specialized transduction. But before I talk about transduction specifically, I just want to talk about bacteriophage life cycles. So I've probably talked about this in previous videos, but we'll go over it a little bit more. And that is that there's two separate life cycles that we talk about generally, and they are the lytic life cycle and the lysogenic life cycle. So the lytic cycle, basically, the phage quickly replicates and kills the host cell. So it results in death of the host cell, lysis. The viral DNA remains separate from the host DNA and replicates independently. So it doesn't get integrated into the bacterial chromosome at all. The viral DNA remains separate, it replicates independently, and eventually produces virons, and they get released during lysis. So the generally lytic, you might ask, what are the conditions under which the lytic cycle is more, I guess, efficient? When is it used more, and when wouldn't it want to be used? So anyway, generally this lytic cycle is used when the host cell conditions are good, okay? And if they're not good, then they're very, very bad in the cases where they're very bad. So if the cell becomes damaged, if the cell can no longer survive, then, you know, we see the lytic cycle being the dominant form. So bacteria also divide quickly, we know that by binary fission, but the phage replicate even faster. And the ultimate result of this whole process is the death of the cell, so the bursting of the cell, and the cell lyses and it releases more of these virons to infect other bacterial cells. So we can kind of see that process here in the diagram. It's a real simple version of it, and it's perfect for what we need it for. So basically the phage have to attach to the host cell, okay, they inject their DNA. There's the bacterial chromosome. Remember, I said it remains separate. So now you kind of have this transition point where you can go either way. You can either enter the lysogenic cycle or you can enter the lytic cycle. In this case, we're talking about the lytic cycle, so we want to move on in that direction. So the phage DNA, it circularizes, it enters the lytic cycle, or in this case, not the lysogenic cycle. And right after that, we start to see the replication. Okay, we start to see the synthesis of proteins, viral proteins, and DNA. Okay, so basically the new phage DNA proteins are synthesized, and they're also assembled at this point into virons. And at a certain point, when several of these virons have been assembled, the cell lyses. It releases the phage virons into the environment, and they can infect another cell, and the process can either begin all over again, or you can have it get to that transition point that I talked about here and go into the lysogenic cycle instead. So the lysogenic cycle, the phage nucleic acid actually integrates into the host cell chromosome, so you're actually going to see that in the genome and in the bacterial chromosome. So the newly integrated genetic material produces what we now call a prophage, okay? It replicates only when the host genome divides, and generally it's lysogenic under moderate conditions. So this is under conditions that are okay, basically. They're not ideal, they're not good, but they're not terrible. So the cell's not damaged, the cell's not in jeopardy of dying, so to speak. And what ends up happening is we have this lysogenic cycle. And at some point, though, these phage become lytic again. They enter that lytic cycle, and they eventually do lyse and release these viron particles into the environment. An example would be maybe UV radiation exposure can cause this to happen. So that's one way of, that's just one way, but basically some stress from the environment, or some unnatural stress that's created by some scientist in the lab, whatever the case may be, but damages the cell. And it enters the lytic cycle, boom, we end up with a release of new viron particles, so we get the same process that we saw before. The proteins are synthesized, assembled into virons, and we enter the lytic cycle, release more into the environment. So that's the basic idea behind the different types of life cycles that we see. Now we can talk a little bit about transduction and the actual process and how that works. So start out with generalized transduction, and I put in parentheses up here that this is the lytic cycle. So generalized transduction basically involves the lytic cycle. And in this process, you could take any gene from a donor cell and transfer it to a recipient cell. Okay, and the way this works, essentially, in very, very basic terms, is that when these phage are assembling, okay, they're synthesizing proteins and DNA, and they're assembling, they mistake their own genetic material for the actual bacterial cells' genetic material. So they package some of the bacterial cells' genetic material into the capsid, and when the cell lyses, that then becomes what gets injected into the bacterial cell. Okay, and that's how the gene transfer occurs, basically. So bacteriophages are capable of generalized transduction. They have trouble distinguishing their own DNA from the host cell when packaging DNA into the capsid. And pieces of the bacterial host DNA accidentally become packaged into the phage capsid. The phage carries the host DNA, are called transducing particles. So that's just a term here I'm kind of introducing. So the phage that carry these host DNA, carries host DNA, are called transducing particles. When transducing particles inject their DNA into the cell, no new phages are produced. So we don't see that process of synthesis of proteins and genetic material that results in the production of new viruses and virons. But basically what happens is no new phages are produced, but the hijacked host DNA can recombine. So this is where the gene transfer occurs. What we see is this host DNA that was packaged incorrectly into the capsid can now recombine and exchange sequences with the host, with a new host chromosome. Okay, so it infects, it goes to attempt to infect another bacterial cell. The bacterial cell doesn't get infected because it's not carrying the viral genes. It's carrying these bacterial genes from another cell, and those genes then enter and they can recombine and exchange sequences with the new host cell chromosome. So it's actually kind of interesting. The bottom line is it's a lytic cycle, and it can take any gene from a donor cell. Then we have this process called specialized transduction. And basically, specialized transduction just means that we have this restricted movement of the host genes, okay, flanking the phage attachment site. So we no longer can take any gene. We're taking only certain genes, okay, certain genes flanking this specific attachment site. So the resulting transduction chromosome becomes partially diploid for the transferred genes. And, of course, the point of specialized transduction, hence the name, is that only certain genes are transferred in this case. So specialized transduction results in what's called a lysogenic life cycle. So we talked about a lysogenic life cycle. That's where it's incorporated into the host cell genome, where the DNA is integrated into the host cell genome or bacterial chromosome. And at some point, the DNA is basically removed from the host chromosome, only it now has some genes from the host cell chromosome along with it. So it carries some of these genes flanking this phage attachment site where the phage DNA or genetic material is incorporated into the host cell chromosome. So the phage on rare occasions will improperly excise their DNA sequences, so they'll actually remove, of course, certain genes from the host cell chromosome, basically, that lay adjacent to the phage insertion site. And what that yields is viruses that lack a few viral genes, but include some adjacent host cell genes. So it's not the case where they don't have all, where they're all viral genes or all bacterial genes, but they actually have just a few. Okay, they have a few of the viral genes, and they have some genes that don't belong to the virus, actually part of the host cell chromosome that it was, that this genetic material was excised from.